Boker Tov, everyone. Rabbi Eric Solomon here, Raleigh, North Carolina. A little more morning Torah. Got a bright sun out there today. It's a beautiful day. Parshat Vayishlach. This is the continuing ongoing story of Jacob and Esau, Yaakov and Esav. They are not in good relationship with each other. They're struggling. And really, one of the key moments in the whole Torah portion, you know, Esau's really upset at Jacob. Jacob stole the birthright, the blessing. Esau, legitimately, is really angry, and Jacob goes far away. This is the Torah portion when they come back and reunite, basically. And Jacob prepares for that, sets up his family, his crew. He's worried. You know, he sends gifts to Esav. He's worried Esav's going to kill him. So he does anything he can to bow down to him, to be humble before him as they approach one another. And the very dramatic moment, they do actually come together, and the way that Torah is so dramatic, it feels like possibly Esau's going to kill him. In the end, they embrace. The Torah says they went on each other's necks and they wept beautifully, it says. And the trope, in fact, is very unique there. The cantillation, it's almost shocked by this level. It's a dramatic moment of real reconciliation. Now, what's even more interesting after that is that after they reconcile and they have some interesting dialogue together, and Esav says, look, you can keep things, and they kind of want a little bit of a moment of reconnecting. Jacob says, you know what? I think we're going to separate. I want to go to this place, a different location in the part of that area, and Esav's going to go here, and they decide to kind of live two separate lives. Even though they did reconcile, and they did find a way forward, and the hug happens, and tears, they go separate ways and live kind of separate lives. Until the Torah portion actually tells us, when Yitzchak, their father, Isaac, dies, they both go together to bury him, which is a profound moment as well. So what do we learn from this piece? So look, you know, Esau gets a real bad rap, a little bit in the Torah, but really in rabbinic tradition. He is seen as not only the bad brother, but as like an example throughout Jewish history of the enemy or the other side of Jewish challenge. But if you look at the text itself, you know, Esau is not such a bad character. He's given the raw end of the stick, really. So they don't enjoy each other. They don't get along well. Jacob's deceitful. He's trickster. You know, Jacob evolves, but he's got his own challenges. Both of them do, okay? But in the end, they do come together enough to say, listen, essentially, we got to find a way to work this out. We are family. We love each other. But they also don't particularly want to spend a lot of time with each other. They don't really like each other, one might say. And they decide to live most of their lives separate from each other, even though they've kind of found a way to be together and to come together on a meaningful family occasion, like the funeral of their father. I put that out there, you know, here in light of Thanksgiving. You know, we're going to be coming together, many of us, if we're blessed to do so with COVID and all the dynamics, with family. And with family, you know, it can be complicated. There are family that we can't wait to see, family we may see all the time, and some family that we avoid seeing because it's too difficult and challenging. We may love them. We may not actually like them. And so I think that this Thanksgiving, one intention from the Torah here is to say is that it's natural, even brothers, even kind of fraternal twins, that have so much in common, DNA, culture, family, upbringing, may not actually like each other that much. But can we find a way, the Torah is kind of explaining, to come together and be together at moments of import, but also not push it or have unreasonable expectations? Jacob and Esau understood that it's not going to be perfect in some kind of Hollywood ending. The Torah recognizes that family relationships are complicated and family's not necessarily going to get along well and not necessarily want to spend a lot of time together, but on key moments are going to do their best. And I put out a special prayer to those in us in our world that either have family that are no longer in this world that they would love to spend Thanksgiving with, or Shabbat for that matter, or those family members where there's estrangement or distance for various reasons they can't come together. It's a deep and profound pain. The message of the Torah is that, you know, one should make very significant efforts, even with painful situations, to try to come together. Obviously, in abusive circumstances and, you know, legal issues, you know, it's not possible and shouldn't come together. But in the normal mundane, regular challenges that families have, there are times to come together. That's what Jacob and Esau tell us. Even people who don't get along or angry at each other, have legitimate reasons we upset with each other, there's an effort there. There's a Torah value. But it also means you don't have to stay there all the time. Thanksgiving could be short. You know, that doesn't have to be forever. It could be just me a moment. And to also come together in those moments that are most critical, when someone's ill, when someone's dying. That's a mitzvah too. And that's what Jacob and Esau do for their father. So I leave that out there for us to consider in light of Thanksgiving. You know, family is complicated. We may have a certain love we may not particularly like, but the Torah is telling us in those complicated dynamics, we should do our best to try to come together for what's most important. Wishing everyone a Shabbat Shalom, and please God, a meaningful and joyful Thanksgiving. Shabbat Shalom.